you will turn with me in your Bibles to the first chapter of the Gospel of Luke. Now, normally I've been working through Sermon on the Mount, but it's Christmas season, so we will deal in this first Sunday of Advent and for the next three or four Sundays with what the Bible says about Jesus Christ's birth and the events that led up to that birth in the Gospel of Luke. I came across a story this week. It's about a man who decided he wanted to break in to a home. So he waited until it was late at night. He looked into the windows. There were no lights on. He rang the doorbell and no one answered. So he broke into the house, opening the door and looking around to see if anyone was there. And he found that there was no one there. And he went a little further in the house and he called out, "Is anyone home?" And he heard a voice that said, "I see you, and Jesus sees you." He went a little further in the house. He was getting worried. He said, "Is anyone there?" And again he heard the voice, "I see you, and Jesus sees you." So he pulled out his flashlight, went into another room, and to his relief, he saw a parrot. But then, right below the parrot was a Doberman pincher, and the parrot said, "Attack, Jesus, attack." I'm sure that thief was surprised. But now I want to look at the Gospel of Luke about another big surprise that two people are going to have during the Christmas, well, not the Christmas season, the season of Jesus' birth, you could say, in the Bible. Let's read and see what God's Word says to us this morning. "Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the Word have delivered them to us, it seemed good to me also, having followed all the things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainly concerning the things you have been taught. In the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughter of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth, and they were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord, but they had no children, because Elizabeth was barren. Both were advanced in years. Now while he was serving as priest before God, when his division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense. And they appeared to him an angel of the Lord, standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, 'Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayers have been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great before the Lord. And he must not drink wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just to make ready for the Lord a people prepared.' And Zechariah said to the angel, 'How shall I know this? For I'm an old man and my wife is advanced in years.' And the angel answered him, 'I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God, and I was sent to speak to you and bring you this good news. And behold, you will be silent and unable to speak until the day these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time. And the people were waiting for Zechariah, and they were wondering at his delay in the temple. And when he came out, he was unable to speak to them. And they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple. And he kept making signs to them and remained mute. And when his time of the service was ended, he went to his home. And after these days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she kept herself hidden, saying, "Thus the Lord has done for me in the days when he looked on me to take away my reproach amongst people." Let's pray and ask God's blessing on his word. Our Savior and our God, the story seems fantastic, but it's true. Convince us in our hearts this morning that you, our God, can do unexpected things in unexpected ways. Help us now to believe, especially during this Christmas season when there's so many temptations for us to take our eyes off of you. Hear our prayer. Amen. William Everett was a congressman from Massachusetts in the late 1800s. He told a story about a small church in England which was broke. They wanted to get new hymnals, but they just couldn't afford it. And they found that there was a patent medicine company who would help them buy new hymnals for 1 penny apiece. Well, the church said, that's a good deal. The only requirement was that the company wanted to have an advertisement in the hymnals. So they said, well, what could be wrong with that? They bought the hymnals, and on Christmas, the minister got up and said, turn to hymn number 138. And they started to sing, "Hark, the herald angels sing, Beecham pills are just the thing, peace on earth and mercy mild, 2 for man and 1 for child. Do you think they got a surprise at Christmas? Sure they did. And most of us who are adults, we've been around the block for Christmas. We don't get too many surprises during the Christmas season. We may get surprised by the politically correct things to say about Christmas, such as this: no longer Frosty the Snowman, it's Frosty the Person of Snow, or Rudolph the nasally empowered reindeer. Now, those things may surprise us. But after years of sitting in church and hearing Luke's gospel and the Christmas narratives over and over again, it's hard for us to get surprised about what the Bible says. But if you went back to the time of Jesus, to the time of Zechariah and Elizabeth, well, there was a surprise. And it caught a lot of people by surprise. As we look at this passage, we can certainly get caught up in the story of Zechariah and Elizabeth, and we should. But what draws my attention, and should probably draw all of our attentions this morning, is what it says about the God we worship. A God who does unexpected things. The God who does unexpected things. He makes a new beginning in salvation. A God who does unexpected things and answers all prayers. A God who does unexpected things, and he takes away our disgrace. Did you ever think about new beginnings and a new start? Did you ever think about what it would be like to go back in time and make different decisions about a career choice, where you went to school? Some of us would like a new beginning, a new start. Well, in this passage, it tells us about the new beginning and unexpected God is going to give to his people. And it seemed for people in Zechariah's and Elizabeth's day that there would be no new changes. Life would pretty much go on as it seems. God hadn't spoken to his people in over 400 years. And when you think about that time period, that is longer than our nation has existed. In fact, it's longer than many nations in the world have existed. But for 400 years, nothing new from God. And if you go back to what he said in the Bible, his last words, it was this: "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before that great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of fathers to the children and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with the decree of utter destruction." It seems in those final words from the Old Testament, there's a blessing, but there's also a curse. And I wonder about all those people who lived in Israel, did they think that the curse had come? It reminds me of that old Simon and Garfunkel song, "The Sounds of Silence." God wasn't speaking. He wasn't acting. It seemed as if the glory had departed. And it makes me wonder, have you ever felt that way? The glory has departed. Life just goes on. There are no new changes. God is not going to do anything new for you, for this nation, for this world. However, as we look at this story, that's not the case, is it? Because look at what's going to happen to Zechariah. The forerunner of Jesus is going to be born to this elderly couple. A couple who seemed to be barren, couldn't have a child. And we are told that Zechariah, a priest, in verse 6, his number had come up for this righteous man who walked blamelessly in the commandments and statutes of the Lord. Wasn't perfect, but he was obedient. And his number came up to go into the temple and offer sacrifices to the Lord God. Now, this is a once-in-a-lifetime experience for a priest because there were so many. This would be the high point of his career. So he goes in to offer up those incense, and there he meets the angel Gabriel, and he is scared. Because when you meet an angel of light, that's the usual response. And the angel said to him, "You're going to have a child, Zechariah. You're going to call him John. And he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wilderness, to the wisdom of the just, to make ready the Lord and the people." Those verses remind us of Isaiah chapter 40, where God says to prepare a way for his coming. And the child, the miracle baby that would be born to an elderly couple who seemed cursed, would bring the good news of the gospel to God's people. In the words of Barney Fife, this is big. Very big. This is the biggest surprise of all. And so when we think of the unexpected God who does unexpected things in unexpected places, here's what he's doing. He's offering salvation anew. Now, children, teenagers, you may still expect something unusual at Christmas. I remember growing up where parents would send you to bed. There was nothing under the tree. You'd wake up at 6 o'clock in the morning, and they'd say, "Go back to sleep." You'd wake up at 7 o'clock, the parents would tell you, "Go to sleep." 8 o'clock, finally, they'd let you get up, and you'd go downstairs, and there'd be all these wondrous toys or packages underneath the Christmas tree. We're excited as children. But let me ask you, if you are an older adult here, if you're an adult, if you've been in this church for years, do you still expect God to do something unique? Do you expect him to surprise you on occasion? As Scripture said, his way is not our way. And if this passage is teaching us anything, it's about the very character of God, who can do new things in salvation. And we may have a desire in our hearts for people to become changed, to come into the kingdom. And we may think it's not going to happen. But remember, a God who is all-powerful can surprise us in the ways that he works. There's an English novel about a small town in Wales. And during the 19th century, this small town would gather together on Christmas Eve at someone's house, and there they would sing, and they would pray, and then after a while, they would go to a dilapidated house. They would put up a manger scene. They would sing more hymns and pray, and there was a myth in this town that if everybody gathered at this one house with perfect faith and prayed on Christmas Eve, the Lord God would come. But for 500 years it hadn't happened. One of the main characters in the story asks an older man, "Do you believe he's going to come this year?" "No, I don't think he's going to come this year." He was asked again, "Well, why are we here?" And the man said, "What if he comes and I'm not here? What if Jesus comes and I'm not here?" For that elderly character in that English novel, even though he may have been jaundiced about what was going on, he still held out that little bit of hope that an unexpected God can do some unexpected things in an unexpected time. Never forget that the Christmas season is about that. The God who surprises us. And notice what else we find out about this passage. It's the God of the unexpected who answers old prayers. You know, we need to admit that we are suspicious of prayer, of what God can do. And I want you to picture what's going on with these frustrated people here in Luke 1. She wanted a child. He wanted a child. Now, you would think, well, God, you should answer their prayer. After all, it says in verse 6, they're blameless and they're upright. Not perfect, but they were generally probably better than everybody else. They had probably prayed for years, "Lord, bless us with a child." But it didn't happen. And in that environment back then, if you were a family, and especially if you were a woman and you did not have a child, you were looked down upon. There was something wrong with you. Perhaps you had sinned. And can you imagine Zachariah and Elizabeth laying in bed at night after they'd watched late night TV, turning to one another and saying, "What's wrong with us? Why have you done this to us, Lord?" Or perhaps in their visit to Walmart, as they're walking through, picking up a few things for dinner, they see a child in the cart hugging his father, and they say to themselves, "Why can't God give us that?" And I'm sure they prayed. And what does verse 13 tell us? The angel says, "Don't be afraid. Your prayer has been heard." And we could also go on to say, "Your prayer has been answered." Because our God is the one who answers those very old prayers that we utter up. Jimmy Lyons was a Presbyterian minister who died recently. For years he had problems smoking cigarettes, and he didn't want to do that. He knew the risks. And he told me one time, he said, "I prayed and I prayed and I prayed, and it didn't seem to work. Then when he was older, God finally answered that prayer." Sometimes we want God to do things quickly. And when we hear silence, we think, "Well, God, you're just not interested. You're not listening." No, it's not that God's not listening. He may be waiting for the right time to do something. Sarah and Andrew, as I think about baptizing your child this morning, and I think of little Brayden, and I think of Paisley, and I think of Cooper. Prayers are going to be offered up, just as your mother and I offered up prayers for you. And you need to remember that sometimes those prayers may seem like they're going to go unanswered. But yet, God may be waiting for the right time to answer prayers of salvation, prayers of healing, and prayers of hope. Because God has his own way of doing things. Don't have the attitude of Zechariah here. In the Peterson paraphrase, it says his response to the angel was, "Do you expect me to believe the foolishness of God?" Foolishness of God is really wisdom. And God answers in his own time and in his own way. I like what Philip Brooks said. Pray the largest prayers. You cannot think a prayer so large that God, in answering it, will not wish you had made it larger. Pray not for crutches. Pray for wings. As a church, don't we need to hear that same type of advice? Some of you have been praying for the health of this church for years. Maybe old, or you're growing old. God can answer those prayers. Don't give up. It is the nature of God to surprise us. And finally, let me say one other thing from this passage. Because it's not only the God of the unexpected who brings a new time of salvation. It's not only the God of the unexpected who answers old prayers. It's the God of the unexpected who takes away our disgrace. Look at what Elizabeth says in verse 25. "The Lord has done for me in this days when he looked upon me to take away my reproach among people." She embarrassed? Oh yes. No kids. And historically that was bad. But God is the God who comes to those who are lacking something. In Elizabeth's case, a child. And for some of you, you may feel like you are the outcast of society because of what you lack. The God of the Bible supplies those needs. And most of all, the disgrace that we need taken away is the disgrace of sin. And what John will ultimately point to is that Jesus Christ is coming to take away the disgrace of sin. And when does that happen? When does he take that away in your life? And when you believe, you become a child of God. You become part of his heavenly family. And there is no more disgrace. Because our unexpected God does unexpected things in unexpected ways. For Christmas, it may be the same old turkey, the same old ties, the same old tinsel. But God is a God who can act in unexpected ways, does something that is old but yet new. He redeems and he saves. He gives life where there is no life. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we ask now, O Lord, that you will be with us and that you will help us to see you as a God does unexpected things. Continue to surprise us. Hear our prayer. Amen.